The nations of Industria and Servidonia are both relatively small nations that have gained their independence within the last 20 years. Each is looking to grow and develop its economy in order to compete in an increasingly globalized world. They recognize that international trade could help achieve that goal. But the leaders of each nation recognize there will be difficulty competing with larger, more economically developed nations. So, how can these nations participate in international trade to maximize the benefits while minimizing the risks? Let's find out how different countries can work toward this goal. Now, international trade exists on a continuum. Take Industria, for example. This country is an industrial powerhouse. It produces a wide variety of goods and services that consumers demand. But it can't compete with nations like the US and China. So rather than engaging in international trade, the government of Industria wants to ensure that everything the nation's consumers could need or want is produced within the country's borders. This is what economists would refer to as a closed economy, which is an economic model that assumes a nation doesn't engage in trade with other countries. What do you think some of the benefits of this policy are? What about drawbacks? Pause the video for a moment to record your answer. While closed economies are rare these days, some nations may choose this system as a way to maintain complete control over their economic system, protect domestic industries, and ensure national security. But these systems also limit the types of goods and services that consumers have access to, limits the markets that producers have access to, and limits a nation's economic growth. On the other hand, Servidonia has a highly developed economy that specializes in financial services and tech manufacturing. It's pretty wealthy and can flex its economic muscle when trading with other nations. For Servidonia, the best scenario would be the movement of goods and services between nations with few or no barriers, a policy known as free trade. How would this benefit Servidonia? Any risks? Take a second to record your answer. Free trade increases consumer access to more diverse goods and services, increases the number of markets that producers have access to, and fosters a nation's economic growth. But completely free trade can harm a nation's developing industries, force nations to adopt lower labor and environmental standards to compete, and lead to economic dependence on other nations. Most nations fall somewhere between a closed economy and completely free trade in order to maximize the benefits of trade while trying to minimize the negative. For a long time, nations imposed the trade barriers we discussed in our previous lesson to accomplish that goal. But what are some of the drawbacks with using trade barriers? Record your answer in your notes and meet me back here. Creating these barriers without consulting other impacted nations often results in a negative cycle of increasing barriers that ended up hurting economies in the long run. Okay, let's check in for a second. The leaders of Industria and Servidonia want to engage in trade with other countries, but want to avoid some of the risks of full free trade and trade barriers. What would you recommend they do? Pause the video and record your answer in the PDF. There's a pretty good chance that you recommended the leaders discuss or negotiate with each other in order to reach some agreement about how trade between the nations will be conducted. Awesome job! For this section, make sure to follow along and fill in the graphic organizer we've provided in your PDF. In the second half of the 20th century, nations began crafting trade agreements to help maximize the benefits of international trade while minimizing the risks of escalating trade barriers. A trade agreement is a formal agreement between two or more nations that is designed to make trade between the nations easier and more beneficial for all parties involved. Trade agreements can be bilateral, meaning that there are two countries involved. This could be as simple as the US and Canada negotiating how maple syrup is traded between the countries. Or trade agreements can be multilateral, where three or more countries negotiate the deal. A great example of this is NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement that was signed by Mexico, the United States, and Canada in 1994. Some trade agreements even result in what is known as a common market. Common markets allow producers from different countries to import and export goods with no restrictions or trade barriers. And finally, there is an economic union, where members not only allow free movement of goods and services, but share common economic policies. Nations that are part of an economic union, like the European Union, coordinate things like tax rates and labor laws, which has the effect of creating something that acts as a single, larger economy. Okay, pause the video and make sure that you have the graphic organizer completed. At the beginning of this unit, we defined globalization as increased interactions and interconnected relationships of countries, economies, and people around the world. How are trade agreements a response to increasing globalization? Pause for a moment to brainstorm an answer. And don't worry about having the perfect answer. We'll come back to the question at the end of the section. Trade agreements allow nations to reap the benefits of international trade, increasing the choice of goods and services available to consumers, opening new and diverse markets for producers, and promoting economic growth. They also give nations a degree of control over the impact of trade. These agreements allow different countries to negotiate and set terms that create jobs in emerging sectors. For example, a nation may make it easier to import computer chips and smartphone cameras if it wants to increase jobs manufacturing smartphones. These trade deals can also result in a shift of industries and jobs to other countries. Say a nation makes it easier and cheaper to import steel than manufacture it. Production of steel and the jobs associated with it will end up being relocated to a different country. One non-economic result of trade agreements is increased political stability in participating nations. By allowing countries to plan better for the impact of international trade and consider its long-term impact, these agreements can reduce the economic displacement caused by increasing globalization. And reducing that displacement means that citizens are less likely to demand massive social and political changes. But these trade deals mean that nations are growing increasingly interdependent. As goods and services move more freely and we rely more and more on production in other nations, our economic health and success is directly tied to the economic health of our partners in trade. If a significant portion of our trade is exporting goods to Canada, we want the Canadian economy to be healthy and growing in order to ensure that there is demand for our goods. So, take a moment to refine your answer to the question I asked at the beginning of the section. How are trade agreements a response to increasing globalization? Well, if globalization is a force that increases the interactions and interconnected relationships of different countries, trade agreements help define the parameters of these interactions in order to best benefit all the nations involved. Let's take a minute to recap what we covered today. As globalization increases and international trade becomes more important, nations want to ensure that they can take advantage of the benefits offered by trade while minimizing the drawbacks. And while trade barriers are one tool to regulate trade, trade agreements are more preferable because they allow nations to develop mutually beneficial partnerships. In order to ensure that trade agreements end up equitable and mutually beneficial, organizations like the World Trade Organization help oversee the negotiation and implementation of trade deals. In the activity that accompanies the lesson, you're going to take a virtual tour of the WTO to take a deeper look at how it helps nations craft and implement trade agreements. I'll see you in our next unit. But until then, keep investing in yourself, one lesson at a time. See you next time. Hey!